Good. Thanks, everybody, for being here this morning. It's going to be a good day. And so what I'd like to do this morning is to start off with a little bit of declarations. You know, sometimes we get used to hearing the word and we agree with it. And that's part of faith. And it can stir faith and impart faith to us. It stirs that up in us. But there's a receiving muscle, and there's an expressing and a doing muscle. I think in 2 Corinthians it says, "Therefore, having the same spirit of faith, we also believe and we also speak." Amen. And so there's that beginning to speak it. One of the things that I find is that sometimes people think that they have faith because they agree with what the preacher says. And that's a deception. Faith is not what you agree with. Faith is what you live by. Mm-hmm. Right? The just will live by faith. And so agreement, obviously, is part of that. You're not going to live by it if you don't agree with it. But if you're hearers only of the word and not also doers, then you can deceive yourself. And the deception is that you're hearing it and agreeing with it actually is faith. Faith is not what you hear and agree with. That's part of faith. Faith is what you also do. It's what you live by. All right, so one of the things that helps bridge that gap is that we start saying and speaking and coming into a line with our, by expressing it with our bodies. And so speaking is part of that, right? You actually have to use your physical tongue to get it out there. You put yourself on the line a bit. And so if you're not in the habit of doing that, some of you probably already are. But one of the things that I want to just kind of lead us into is so that you can see, you can take these truths that you've been learning, and rather than just studying them, and one of the most powerful ways to get it into you is meditate, and a very powerful way to meditate is actually to speak out your confessions, to take the Word of God, make it your own. All right. So if you've got a Bible, you can turn there. We're going to go to Mark chapter 16, verses 15 through 18. And while you're turning, I'm going to begin to read them, and then I'm going to read it all the way through, and then what we're going to do is we're going to all stand up, and I'm going to begin to turn the Word of God into our confession. I'm going to say it, then you're going to repeat after me. Okay? But you can do this on your own just by using the Scriptures. It's very powerful. Mark chapter 16, starting at verse 15. "And he said to them, 'Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. He who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved, but he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. And they will lay hands on the sick and they will recover.'" Amen?
Amen.
That's the Word of God. So, now, stand up. And you just repeat after me, okay? I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
He is my Lord.
He is my Lord.
He is my Savior.
He is my Savior.
And I am under orders.
And I am under orders.
I am authorized by heaven.
I am authorized by heaven.
To go.
To go
into all the world.
Into all the world.
Wherever I go.
Wherever I go.
I have heaven's authority.
I have heaven's authority.
To proclaim the gospel.
To proclaim the gospel.
The good news.
The good news.
That God is real.
That God is real.
That God loves us.
That God loves us.
That Jesus is victorious.
That Jesus is victorious.
That hell has been defeated.
That hell has been defeated.
That we can have forgiveness.
That we can have forgiveness.
That we can have life with God.
That we can have life with God.
Forever.
Forever.
And I proclaim this.
And I proclaim
because I believe it.
Because I believe it.
And I have believed.
And I have believed.
And I have been baptized.
And I have been baptized.
I have immersed myself.
I have immersed myself.
Into God.
Into God.
Into the name.
Into the name.
Of the Father.
Of the Father.
The Son.
The
And the Holy Ghost.
And the Holy Ghost.
I am saturated with God.
I am saturated with God.
The old me is gone.
The old me is gone.
He has died and been buried.
He has died and been buried.
And I am raised new.
And I am raised new.
I live in the name of Jesus.
I live in the name of Jesus.
I live in the power of Jesus.
I live in the power of Jesus.
And I am saved.
And I am saved.
I am rescued.
I am rescued.
I am delivered.
I am delivered.
I am kept safe from all harm.
I am kept safe from all harm.
And the power of evil.
And the power of evil.
I will not be a disbeliever.
I will not.
And I shall never be condemned.
I shall never be condemned.
Because there is no condemnation in Christ.
Because there is no condemnation in Christ.
And signs follow me.
And signs follow me.
Because I am a believer.
Because I am a believer.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
And His power flows through me.
And His power flows through me.
I have been given the name of Jesus.
I have been given the name of Jesus.
I don't live in my own name.
I don't live in my own name.
I live in His name.
I live in His name.
And in His name I cast out demons.
And in His name I cast out demons.
Hell must obey me.
Hell must obey me.
Because I speak in the name of Jesus.
Because I speak in the name of Jesus.
I am a believer.
I am a believer.
I do speak in new tongues.
I do speak in new tongues.
This is for me.
This is for me.
Holy Ghost lives in me.
The Holy Ghost lives in me.
He has given me the gift of new tongues.
He has given me the gift of new tongues.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
And I am not afraid of the devil.
And I am not afraid of
him. Or any of his works.
Or any of his works.
I have been authorized by heaven.
I have been authorized by heaven
to destroy the works of the devil.
To destroy the works of the devil.
I do not turn a blind eye.
I do not turn a blind eye.
I am not on the defense.
I am not on the defense.
I am an aggressor.
I am an aggressor.
Against hell.
Against hell.
So I go after serpents.
So I go after serpents.
And I crush them under my feet.
And I crush them under my feet.
And nothing by any means can harm me.
And nothing by any means can harm me.
My body is protected by heaven.
My body is protected by heaven.
If I drink any deadly poison,
if I drink any deadly poison,
it shall not harm me.
It shall not harm me.
My body is blessed.
My body is blessed.
I am kept in good health.
I am kept in good health.
By the covenant of my God.
By the covenant of my God.
And I am a believer.
And I am a believer.
I lay hands on the sick.
I lay hands on the sick.
And they recover.
And they recover.
Because the power of God flows through this hand.
Because the power of God flows through this hand.
To crush disease.
To crush disease.
The works of the devil.
The works of the devil.
To bring healing in life.
To bring healing in life.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, well, let's be seated. Isn't that good?
Yes.
That's a whole lot better. No, God, please help us, ain't it? You know, when you take what God says about you that's already true and you begin to step into that and you begin to align your words and your thinking and your speaking and your mindset and put your heart into that, Spirit of God already believes that. Amen. And Wade and I, we were talking a little bit last night about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I found this also with helping people begin to minister in the power of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I'll tell people that I know, I'm confident they're believers. I'm confident that they have received the Holy Spirit and are inviting His fullness. And they know that they can walk as sons of God, but they're just a little bit, I've never done this before. Sometimes I'll tell them this. I'll say, why don't you just pretend you know what you're doing? Yeah. You know, just pretend. Just pretend that you've been doing this your whole life. And that you see miracles everywhere you go. Sometimes when it comes to ministering the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I will tell people, you know, they'll say, I feel the fullness of the Holy Spirit. But you know what? They don't know yet how to cooperate with the working of the Holy Spirit in speaking in other tongues. And so I'll tell them, I'll tell you what, why don't you do this? Why don't you just really focus on the presence of God and invite His fullness into you? And then just close your eyes and pretend you already have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let it come out. And don't even think about it. Right? Just let it come out. And you just keep doing that. And guess what? You're going to find that your inner man's getting built up because you think you're pretending because you've never done it before. But Holy Spirit doesn't know about pretending. You understand? If to your mind and to your soul, to yourself, it feels like pretend because you've never done it before and it doesn't feel normal to you yet. And there's a part of you that is judging yourself by what you've experienced up to this point and your own perceptions or even misperceptions about how God works in you or through you. And you've been expecting, I need to feel a certain way to get completely overwhelmed, and just all of a sudden it's like, you know, an involuntary reflex, you know, almost like somebody gets nauseous and just can't hold it in, and, you know, it comes out. And you keep waiting for Holy Spirit to make you speak in tongues like that. And some people, that's the way it comes, okay? Because it's important for them. But God, it has a very personal relationship with each one of us. And for others of us, it's very important for us that we, by faith, recognize Holy Spirit does live within us, that everything that Jesus says that we can do, we can do. Amen? And so then we just by faith receive that. Okay, I've got this. Believers can speak in new tongues. Believers can lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Okay, I've got this. I'm a believer. Apparently, this is mine, right? Instead of, well, I haven't experienced that yet, you know, and so I need to wait for it, blah, blah, blah. And then you begin to step into that, and then you begin to realize, wait a second, there's a cooperation that God is making us aware of. And so sometimes people have held back for years because they keep waiting to get slapped upside the head with the power of the Holy Ghost, and they wake up on the floor going, blah, 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 you know. And man, it can happen that way. And if it needs to happen that way for you, it'll happen that way for you. But don't put God in your little box of expectations that I need to get slapped upside the head with an overwhelming power in order for that to work. God doesn't necessarily want to do that for every person in every situation. You see that diversity in the book of Acts, don't you? Acts chapter 2, Holy Spirit came down, rushing wind, fire, it's just going, amen? That it was just automatic. Then you got other situations. Philip, he preached to everybody. They got saved. They got water baptized. They got healed, and demons coming out of people. And he's like, all right, I know that the Holy Spirit and the expression of His supernatural power is also for you. That's the startup package. But it ain't happening. For me, it just happened automatically. I need to get the apostles down here to help. You know, they knew that this was for them too. And so he bridged that gap to bring someone else onto the scene. And what did they do? It says that they ministered hands-on. They worked with people. They got involved. They laid hands and they worked with people so that they began to speak in other tongues as well. Right? So they learned how to cooperate with Holy Spirit. They learned how to let Holy Spirit not just live in them, but to flow out through them. Amen? And so if that's the neat thing about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If it happens automatically, most people who receive it automatically, they believe in it, but they may not know how to minister it to other people because they're like, well, for me, it just kind of happened. I was just really worshiping, really praying intently, and it just started to come out. And so they'll tell people, well, go pray a little bit. And they, you know, and it, well, I did do that and it didn't quite work, you know. And so, but the other thing that you see is that if it didn't happen spontaneously, what was it? There was hands-on personal ministry. That we actually have a place. We don't have to stick people back up in an upper room and just pray and pray and pray until the Holy Spirit comes down and it happens, boom, like that. That there's a couple of different ways. If it didn't happen spontaneously, believers who are baptized in the Holy Spirit, who know how to cooperate with Holy Spirit, now are able to lay hands on others and to minister to them. Because a lot of times people are seeking baptism of the Holy Spirit as if they haven't gotten it yet. and they need heaven to give them something that they haven't yet received. Right? And so there's an element of I'm judging myself by my natural experience rather than believing what the Word of God says, is that that when we have believed in Him, that He has given to us everything pertaining to godliness. Everything belongs to us. Amen? Every spiritual blessing belongs to you as a born-again believer. And so you're not trying to get heaven to give you something that you don't have. You're having to learn how to activate and unlock what you've received. And so a couple of years ago, y'all have had this experience. I don't have it with me, but I did a dumb thing. I got a smartphone. And that thing, man, it was really funny. I realized at first all I was doing is just show me how to set up my voicemail, you know. And then it was like, okay, now I can call and I can text, you know. I was doing about what I was doing with my BlackBerry, you know. and then, you know, my kids started showing me, oh, Dad, you can do this app and you can do this app and this app and, you know, all kinds of cool things. And what I found was that there was a whole lot of capability that I had received when I received the smartphone. That everything in that phone was already mine. But it was very helpful to have somebody who had already activated an app to show me how to activate what I had. Right? And so that's part of the ministry. And so sometimes people are so full of I can't and I'm not sure and blah, 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 and I've never, and they've got so much of this going up in their brain that we need to sort of bypass that to say, why don't you just believe that you already got it? And if it helps me to tell you, well, just pretend. Well, guess what? Holy Spirit really believes in what you're pretending. Well, what I just did is got you past all of your unbelief and your mental hang-ups, right? And then you begin to actually realize, wow, I'm unlocking what I already had, you know. And so it allows your natural man to get past your self-judgments based on a lack of experience, because your natural man believes your experience more than the gospel. And all I did was tell you, no, the Word of God is true. You really have all this already. Why don't you just pretend like you do? Amen? All right. Well, that was bonus material. So this morning, I think to start off with, they have a video queued up of an experience that we had of healing. Very often, there's a lot of cool ministries out there that just take their video cameras out on the streets all the time, and I love those things. I don't know why, but I just found it very difficult to do that. I have not been able to record a lot of things. And so most of the stuff that we have recorded is I'm just doing ministry and somebody said, hey, I was videoing that whole thing, or, you know, because it just works well like that. So this was something that God had somebody videoing and they on their camera phone, and they gave us some of the footage of it, and then we put it together. So y'all take a look at this, and then we can talk about it. And then this morning, one of the things we may want to do is I had some cue cards up here for questions, and nobody's written me a question yet. So y'all either all got this all figured out, or you're trying to wait to see if I'm going to cover your question. You make sure, if you've got questions in your mind, you make sure that I cover them. Help me help you, okay? Because if I'm scratching over here and you're itching over here, we got to get those things together, right? So if you got itches, you need to help me scratch. All right. Well, I've continued to keep in touch with Anya's family and check back with them periodically, and periodically they just check back with me. She actually, what was really cool is that at the end of that ministry session, we were at a hotel and a conference for a conference. So the conference was going on. We were out in the lobby. One of the things that was going on in this ministry time is that the hotel manager was obviously Muslim, and he was standing there watching this whole thing going, rolling his eyes, you know, doing a little frowny face and all kind of stuff like that. probably some because we're out there in the lobby doing this, and partly because I think he was very skeptical about what was happening. As soon as she took off, started walking like that, his countenance went, oh. And then he took off. I didn't see him the rest of the time. He was just back in the back. You know, I think he was just really trying to evaluate what he had just witnessed. The other thing that was really cool is that at the end of that day, at the end of that evening, when we're all hugging the parents and saying goodbye and exchanging contact information and this kind of stuff, Anya walks over to where the automatic doors get triggered. She looks back over her shoulder with a big old grin and goes, "Waste you to the car," and takes off. I saw her. Saw our parents the next morning. They drove back over for a church service, and I saw them there. That's where we got that initial video at the beginning, you know, where the dad and the mom were speaking to give a little testimony. They said that night she got home and she played with her brother and her sister for an hour in the backyard for the first time. Awesome. And then she went up the stairs on her own for the first time in her life. Since that time, one of the things that you don't see in the video is that she, one of the issues that she was having is that she was having regular reoccurring seizures of different severities, and she did not have seizures from that point. Anya is now very easily walking forwards, backwards, sideways. She's got full coordination. A lot of what you were seeing as residual there was just a lack of, she was learning to walk, literally. I mean, she had never taken more than a couple steps, or standing was hard. She was just falling, collapse. But was very interesting. One of the things that the parents contacted me about not too long after this is that even though they were seeing all this physical improvement in her body and things, one of the things that they were concerned about is that Anya was beginning to wonder whether she was special or not. Right, because the parents had, as many people do when they have children that are born with challenges and things like that, that they begin to make that the source of the child's value. You're special because of this. This makes you unique and special, and so that's kind of been the way that we've compensated. So we take the work of the enemy and make that their identity and their value. And that's part of the deception that's at work in this whole realm of birth defect. Their value and their identity is not in the work of the enemy and the defect. Their value is the same as the rest of us, that we are created in the image and the likeness of God, and that God Himself demonstrated our value by sending Jesus Christ Himself to die for us, to redeem us, to buy us back from the hand and the work of the enemy. Amen. And so that's the ground of all of our value. And so it's important for parents and the church and children to have that sown into them, to realize that you're special, that you don't get your identity from the work of the enemy any more than you or I do. You know, I mean, there's been times where people take that same sort of theology and, you know, they'll say, you know, they were diagnosed with cancer or some sort of thing, and then the pastor comes around, "Well, you must be very special for God to give you this kind of a trial." I've heard those kind of things. But you know, you might think it's a little screwy when you hear it in that realm. But then when parents have a child that's born diagnosed, for example, with Down syndrome, that they think all of a sudden that's the proper pastoral approach. Well, you must be very special for God to trust you with this kind of a trial. And so we need to realize that there's a faith threshold that we've put out there arbitrarily without any justification from Scripture to say, well, since this is genetic defect, since this is birth defect, we come with some sort of theology that, okay, that this must be the way that God wants them since they were born this way. That's pretty much the way people arrive at that. But had they been born with, some disease like leukemia, or born with a disease that had some medical treatment, you know, pneumonia, or something like to that effect, you wouldn't come in and say, okay, now, you know, you're weird for seeking their healing. You know, you'd be weird if you didn't seek their healing, right? If they had medical conditions. But we have this mindset that if there's a medical solution that man has come up with, then it's okay to also pray for their healing, right? Divine intervention. But if there's no solution that man has, I mean, there is no medical solution for genetic defect in a lot of these things out there. There's just no so then people begin to think there's something wrong with the parent to believe God that the wounds on Jesus' back and those stripes are also for them, for their children. Amen. And so that's part of what had, really got hold of a group of people, that was part of that whole book that we co-authored, a lady named Margaret Wysoom. At the time she lived in South Carolina, God had really got a hold of her heart with this message. She had a child that was born with a diagnosis. And she began going after this partially because she had already gotten a hold of this message and was ministering healing, because she had been told her whole life that, you know, all of her husband's afflictions, because her husband had some severe health challenges, were part of God's special plan for their life. And she's like, this just doesn't seem right. And she started studying this out, and she came across this message, and it just really helped lock things in for her. And she started going after healing for her husband, and man, now their lives are back on track. They had a child that was born with a diagnosis, and she's like trying to study this out. Is there any difference between this, what my husband was going through, and my child? Now, this is the point where a lot of us, our faith breaks down. So I just, I want to let you know that we don't need anybody to be healed in order for us to love them. Amen. We love everybody, no matter when they have value, just as they are. But we need to let their value be exactly what God says it is. Amen. That they are worth dying for their forgiveness and redemption. They're worth being filled with the Holy Spirit so they can manifest God. They're also worth going to the whipping post for, so they can be set free from this affliction in their bodies. Amen. That's what God says about them. So who are we to say that doesn't count for you? You don't qualify for that. We don't say that. We have no right to say that. If we're saying that, we're saying something different than what heaven says. So this is important for us. Now, this blows most of our minds. It really does. It blows my mind, but that's a good thing. Let's just go ahead and let our minds be blown. Okay? How about we just start loving God, loving people, and believing God for God-sized things? Now, every now and again I have to remind myself that the whole human race started when God made a lump of clay and took a deep breath and went, whew. Yep. Amen?
That's right.
That from that point, there were bones formed that were there were no bones. There were organs formed where there were no organs. There was nervous systems, circulatory systems where there were no circulatory systems or nervous systems. There was whole endocrine systems that were put into place that were perfectly functioning. There was a brain, eyeballs, in all of the optical nerve centers and all of those things, just because Almighty God went into some dirt. How about we start just believing God and letting the breath of God go and do what only He can do? Amen?
Amen.
Now, so that's an amazing thing. That's an amazing thing. Well, we're pressing in. We're seeing God do things. But I want to let you, I'm standing up here. I said something last night, and I do say this. I do not yet see 100% results of instantaneous miracles in every situation that I minister to. But I want to let you know, that is not what my faith level is. I do not come here to give you my ministry. My faith is not in my track record. My faith is in Jesus' ministry. I see 100% results in His ministry. And so I'm trying to get over my ministry, and I quit my ministry every day and say, Jesus, You have Your ministry. Because my ministry can't help a soul. But Jesus' ministry can just do what no man can do. Amen? That's a good thing. So, part of the difference between the getting over your ministry, your life, and getting on it so that you're actually participating in the life of, in the ministry of someone else, is you begin to, you know, get you step across that line to say, okay, I'm not going to believe or think about me anymore, because I was crucified 2,000 years ago. And I'm not going to try to use someone else to improve me. I'm going to be done with me. I'm going to deny myself. I'm going to say, you know, what God says, that 2,000 years ago, I was crucified with Christ. God's not trying to improve me. Okay? He said, if I could improve it, I would have. But what I'm going to do is, you know, all those things that you feel like, man, I wish I could improve this. I'm so sick of this. I wish I could be done with this. Oh, I hate this about me. And you get frustrated with yourself, you know? And you're like, oh, God, please, you know? And you're trying to get God to improve you. And God the whole time is just saying, ah, not my plan, not my plan. Not my plan. You know, people joke and they say, you know, don't pray for more patience. You know, God, help me to become more patient. You know what, God, you know what ends up happening when you pray those things? Here's the deal. Does it feel like you become more patient? No. It feels like what happens is God lets the floodgates open and He brings all kinds of stuff into your life so that you will get over the hope, the wish, and the dream that you could ever be patient. Patience is not in you, and it is not His plan to help you be anything except come to the end of you trying to be something and you just become a vessel of Him. Amen?
Amen.
You start participating in someone else's life. I had a friend that I was meeting with. I love this story. I'm probably going to tell it again tomorrow, but Y'all get it twice, all right? And I like it every time I tell it, so hopefully you'll enjoy it tomorrow too. I had a friend I was meeting with. I was trying to help him understand who he was in Christ and the difference of living by his life and that kind of thing. And, you know, it was hard for him to get it, partially because he was always listening to it from a legalistic point of view. You know, like, so you're saying just because Christ lives in me that nothing I do matters anymore? I can go over there and steal all them donuts and, you know, that doesn't matter. You know, and I was, no, did I say that? I didn't say that. Why are you acting? You know, it's like, he's like, listen, you know. Anyway, so it was kind of frustrating, but for about 3 or 4 weeks we had these meetings, and then finally there was a point where you could just, sometimes you can tell when somebody hears from God. It's like they go quiet and their eyes go, you know, and they're just like, phew, this holy hush comes over their face. And he said, I think I understand what you're trying to say now. Can I share with you what I think you're saying? And I said, sure. And then he started telling me a story. And I thought, man, I know he's got it now, because God speaks in stories a lot of times. It just kind of came all at once in a big picture for him. Here's what he told me. He said, when I was growing up, my dad was a deadbeat. And my parents divorced, okay? And so there was a summer when I was in high school that I went to go live with my dad. And at that time, I was very into BMX bicycle racing, okay? My mom, though, would not let me take my really good racing bike to my dad's house. But my dad had this old beater Pee Wee Herman Murray bike with the wraparound handles and the big, you know, 46-inch tires and the rims. And it was, you know, I don't know if it had one of them Ooga Ooga horns on it or not, but it wasn't cool for a teenager. But it had even been outside, so it was kind of rusty. So he started doing some odd jobs and bartering around the neighborhood and doing with what he could with what he had. And he scraped it down, painted it, traded some handlebars, traded some seats and stuff like that. And towards the end of the summer, he got this thing kind of to where he wasn't just totally ashamed to be seen on it. And so he decided, oh, okay, it's ready. So he got it and he starting to drive around the neighborhood, and at some point the tire popped and he brought it back to the garage, set it in the garage, and it just so happened it was time for him to go off for a weekend to like a weekend thing that his mom had arranged for him. And as they were getting ready to go out, his dad asked him and said, "Son, is there anything I can do for you while you're gone?" He said, "Well, Dad, I've been working on this bike all summer long. It'd mean a lot to me if you could get the tire replaced, we get the new inner tube for it and have that fixed when I get back, because, you know, I don't have much time when I get back." And he said, and his dad looked at him and said, "Son, I got it. I got it covered. No problem." And for him, he's like, my dad has never been great at coming through for anything. And so as a young man, I'm finding it hard to trust, but I decided, okay, well, let's wait and see. You know, I just wasn't going to put my, I was starting to let my guard down a little bit, but just let's wait and see. Give him a chance. So he said, I went off to the summer camp and I came back and the garage door is wide open. And I look and I see my bike sitting right where I left it. Tire still completely flat. Said, man, my heart sank. I got angry. I got out of the car, went to the back of the trunk, got my bag out, and I'm halfway between crying in a heap and punching walls. And so, you know, I walk in through the garage, go up the stairs. I just wanted to run in and flop on the bed and cry. I didn't want to see my dad. And I opened the bedroom door, and there, right in the middle of the floor, is a brand new top of the line BMX racer. And he said, it's the first time I ever remember crying in tears of joy. And he said, it really wasn't about the bike. It was that I understood my dad came through, and he knew, you know, like I was important to him, and he didn't, you know, all that I thought wasn't bad, you know. It was like it all just melted right there. And you know, that was an amazing story. And I said, man, this is awesome. What does this have to do with what we've been talking about? And he said, and he got this big grin on his face. He said, I didn't take the tires off of that bike and go fix the old beater in the garage. He said, all of that feeling that I wanted just to get, you know, I was judging my dad by, hey, come fix this old beater bike. You know, the whole time my dad was just waiting for me to come upstairs because he had a brand new, complete, whole bike for me, waiting for me to discover it. And all I needed to do was learn how to ride that bike. I never rode the old one again. And I said, that's exactly right. He said, that's my life in Christ, isn't it? I have a perfect, whole, complete, brand new life that's a brand new identity, that's a brand new me that God's made me. And He's not trying to judge me by the old stuff and try, you know, and I need to stop and just get off the old bike and go upstairs into Christ and learn that He is my life, that He is whole, that He is complete, that He is my righteousness, that He is everything to me, and learn just to learn how to stay on that and never go back and ride that old thing again. If I ever find that I've got on the wrong bike somehow, I just jump off that thing right? How many times do we get on the old man and we start trying to evaluate ourselves and analyze what's wrong with me? And we start trying to, you know, figure out if we just psychologically correct ourselves that that's going to be the solution. And so we spend a lot of times analyzing us and our problems and things like that instead of just get off that thing. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. It just makes your britches dirty with all that rust and dirt and mud that's on the, that flies off the tires. Amen. You need to get on the brand new bike. Ride that top of the line BMX racer. And I said, man, that is an awesome, awesome, awesome illustration. I'm stealing it. It's going in my books. And he goes, okay, no problem. I said, but one thing I tell you, the only way that this could be a better illustration is if your dad had gotten you a Harley. because Jesus comes with power. Amen. It's still living on the earth, but it's living with someone else's power. We do the directing of that power. Amen.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit is our helper.
Yeah.
And so he's waiting for us to learn how to turn the starter key, how to open up the throttle, how to sit, be seated in Christ. You know, I shared this illustration in Milwaukee, and you know, that's where Harleys are made. And there was, I was sitting with the ministry leader and his wife, and we were eating burgers and fries, and the wife said, Oh. And I was like, what? And she said, I just went to a motorcycle safety class this past week. And she said, you would not believe the very first thing that the safety instructor said to us. And I said, I sure wouldn't, because I don't know about riding Harleys. And she said, this is what they said. If you don't learn to trust your bike, you will never be safe. And what he meant was this. You have got to get relaxed and learn to stay seated. That's what you and I need to learn, is we need to learn to stay seated in Christ in heavenly places, to recognize that that's where our place is, that this seatedness in Christ is absolutely firm. That's our firm ground. We're not trying to get God to bless us. We're not trying to get breakthroughs. Christ has broken through and purchased and bestowed upon us every spiritual blessing in the heavens. Realms. It's yours. God is not holding anything back on you. It's like what he went to when the father went to the older son. Everything I have is yours. That's what he says to sons. That's why it's so important that we get over our lack and our sense of inadequacy and our sense of failure and realize that, you know what, you're only judging yourself according to the flesh, and everything about you that you want to be rid of, God crucified it 2,000 years ago. You don't have to improve it to get rid of it. You let it be dead. Amen? It's already dead. And so you step out of that and you step into who you are and what you have in the Lord Jesus Christ, because He has given you a brand new you who is perfect, whole, complete. That is your life. Amen? Yeah. I'm not hearing any amens. Some of y'all are still trying to figure out. This sounds like really too good to be true. Man, it's the gospel. That it is good news.
Yep.
It is good news. Everything that Christ is, God put in our bedroom upstairs. And He's waiting for us to discover it. And it's not a top-of-the-line BMX racer. It is a Harley Davidson. And you can ride that thing down the stairs, man. It's awesome. So it's good. But we got to learn how to ride a bike. Well, ride one of those things, right? Just because you've got one and you own one and it's yours doesn't automatically make you a very competent rider, does it? And so that's part of the learning curve. We're learning how to live by someone else's power. We're learning how to stay rested in someone else's success and to participate in that. Amen? And so that's a good thing. All right. Well, we managed to get right up to 10 o'clock. Tell you what we're going to do is we're going to start hitting what is commonly referred to in the John G. Lake Ministries as sacred cows. Let me give you the definition of sacred cows. We're going to actually, in my ministry, we're going to be taking a team to India in August. That's where that whole mindset comes from, right? Because you've got people that are starving and you've got cows wandering around, plenty enough that they could have plenty of good food to eat. And they could have a barbecue every weekend and just everybody eat well. The problem is they have mindsets and mentalities that allow these cows to live and people to hurt. Okay? And so the whole mindset behind sacred cows is that we as the church have been deceived into embracing mindsets that Christ didn't embrace. About healing and sickness and disease. And a lot of them are based on Bible verses and Bible passages. And so what we're going to do after this break is we're going to start hitting some of those and kind of looking at those more carefully so that we can clear out, because I found that a lot of times people have been well taught from the Bible about why God won't heal, or why God might not heal, or why God can't heal or won't heal you, or what you did wrong to deserve sickness so that, you know, healing's out of the works for you. Do you understand? And so it's just out there. And so if you personally don't believe it, you may have friends, family members, and associates that you are going to come across that it's going to be important for you to be equipped so that, not so that you can out-argue people, but so that you can be more effective at helping people become free. Amen? Because the truth is what sets us free. All right? So let's take maybe 5-minute break. Can we do 5? Just get up, walk around, and then we'll get started here in just a few minutes.